Hey everyone, it's Gina and welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to be taking you through my full hair care analysis report from MyManeBio. I'm so excited to share these results with you guys because I was definitely surprised. I always thought that I had a good understanding of my hair, but this definitely was eye-opening. If you're not familiar with MyManeBio, it's basically an online service where you send in your hair sample and they give you a full report back, and it tells you your hair's porosity, its density, texture, elasticity, and tons of other useful information. My report is pages and pages long. It says it's 39 pages long, which is so useful. I think this is so beneficial if you're just getting started with your curly hair and if you like to just nerd out on this information like I do, because I love learning about hair and the science behind hair, especially naturally curly hair. It's just so complicated and there's so many different characteristics. So I just wanted to thank MyManeBio for providing me with this hair analysis. I actually reached out to them because I had heard so many great things about it and I was really curious, especially because I'm always looking into these details about my hair so I can have the best information to share with you guys. And so I was so thankful that they agreed to provide me with this. That way I can share it with you guys and share with you my results, and hopefully it can help some of you out and better understand if it's the right kind of test for you to get on your hair. They were also so kind to provide me with a discount code too for you all. It's for $5 off, and I will put that coupon in the description box down below. So let's go ahead and get started with the full hair analysis. So when you first place your order on the website, they have two different options. One of them has a little bit more detail to it. It gives you more product recommendations. They actually go through your products and tell you if it's good for your hair or if it's not good for your hair type. And so that's the full hair care analysis that they have. They also have another package that you can get. It's a little bit cheaper, and that one just gives you a little bit less information, but they both give you the main characteristics that you need to know about your hair. So after you place your order, they will send you a kit in the mail, which basically has a little bag to put your hair sample in. They ask about your hair concerns. They ask about where you live so they can determine the climate in your area and if that's affecting your hair. So many different things and what your main hair goals are. And you can also list off the products on here if you get the total hair care analysis. Depending on how many orders they currently have, it could take some time for you to get your results back, but the wait is so worth it. And they send you your PDF document attached to an email, so you get the results by email. So now let's get into my analysis. One of my biggest takeaways from this analysis is my hair is a total mixture of different characteristics. My porosity says it is normal at the root, normal to high porosity at mid-shaft, and high porosity at the tip. Which is definitely what I thought, although I thought I was gonna have high porosity all over. So it is pretty common for people to have multiple different porosities at the different lengths because your ends naturally just get more damage, especially if you diffuse your hair on high heat or if you previously used heat on your hair daily. Even the elements outside, such as sun, can really damage your hair, and the ends tend to just get more friction overall and they're a little bit more exposed than the roots of your hair. So that I wasn't surprised by. Because my hair is normal to high porosity at mid-shaft and high at the bottom, I would probably just consider it high porosity overall because at the root, you know, I don't have to treat the root as much as I do the ends. So the higher porosity part is due to damage, but if I can get that fully grown out, then I would have normal porosity because of the root being normal porosity. So some people are just naturally born with higher porosity hair, which I figured was probably me. But this kind of tells me that if I can keep it up and just take good care of my hair and let it grow out, that it could be normal porosity, which is so much easier to manage. These photos show the hair's porosity, which I've always seen those diagrams and stuff online, but to actually see the photos of my hair's porosity is definitely very helpful and fascinating. So it shows the hair at the root, which is a normal porosity type. And so it says the cuticle layers are flared but fairly even, indicating a normal porosity. So you're gonna be able to see those cuticle layers. If they're flared evenly, then it's more of a normal porosity. And then hair near the tip, which is highly porous due to cuticle chipping, missing cuticles, and flaring. So looking at the difference between the bottom areas of my hair compared to the top at the root, there's a huge difference in the porosity. The next characteristic that they give you is your elasticity. Now, elasticity will tell you if it's balanced with protein and moisture. I recently posted a video all about protein overload with lots of information about how to tell if your hair has protein overload or if it has too much moisture, and I show you a quick, easy routine on how to fix it in one wash. And so in that video, I showed an example of when my hair was imbalanced, and when it's not balanced, it breaks so easily. If you have too much protein in your hair. So my results were that I have 31% stretch to my hair when it is wet, which is normal to borderline low. So that tells me that I need some more protein in my hair. Dry, I have 32% stretch, which is high elasticity. So elasticity is kind of confusing because it's just a balance. Like, you don't want to have too much elasticity, which is a sign of moisture overload, and you don't want to have no elasticity because then your hair is just going to break. So it's good for your hair to have some stretch to it that prevents breakage, especially when you're detangling and stuff when it's wet. Next up is the texture. So this is the one that surprised me the most and was the most shocking because I always thought that I had fine hair. I'm always saying that in videos that I have fine hair, and now I have to take it back because apparently I have 50% medium width, 50% coarse, kinky, and medullated. What? Coarse hair? Who would have thought that I have coarse, kinky hair? Because you think of like type 4 hair types when you think of having coarse hair. So it's 50-50. So I have medium to coarse hair. So guess I don't have fine hair, but so many people confuse hair texture with density because the next characteristic they explain is density, low, thin. So I do have low density hair, so I don't have a lot of hair. Like, when I take my hair into a ponytail, it's like this big. It's very small. So I don't have a lot of hair on my head compared to others, but I have medium to coarse. So that refers to the actual diameter of your hair strand. If your hair strand is very tiny, if it's almost like invisible, if you were to put it against paper, then it's very fine. If it feels like thicker, if you can feel it between your fingertips, then it's more coarse. I've definitely noticed the kinking that I have in my hair because when I run my fingers down my hair, especially in those high porosity areas on the ends, it feels very bumpy, and sometimes I get a lot of tangles in those areas because when it's kinky, it kind of just knots up a lot easier. Basically, the hair's width changes a lot throughout the hair strand when you have kinky hair, and I definitely have some hairs like that. Sometimes I will pick up a piece like this one, for example. It feels so just like rough, and like you can actually see where it changes in thickness, which is probably a sign of damage. I usually see those on the damaged pieces. So then it tells you your width, so it actually gives you a measurement of your width. So I have a 31% reduction in hair width. So this is what tells me that I need a trim. And I knew this about my hair because if you've ever looked at the ends of hair that's damaged, it almost looks translucent at the end, and you can tell that's where you need to cut your hair because that's where it's been damaged so much to where it's just broken down and it's starting to split. And I think that's also why my hair looks so much thicker at the top and it looks so thin at the bottom, and just I have such low density at the bottom because I need to cut those ends off, but then I would have very short hair. So I'm still growing it out. So hair that has the kinking is more vulnerable to cuticle chipping and damage. The suggested trim is about 3 centimeters, so it's like 1.5 inches to remove damage caused by split ends and swelling. This is the other thing that I found interesting. So it says that I had medullas in my hair and slight kinking. So you'll see in the pictures, I'll put some of the photos up here of my hair, but apparently in my research, not everyone has the medulla layer of their hair. It's like the innermost layer of the hair. You have the cuticle layer, the cortex. Medulla layer is the very innermost layer, and it's more common in coarse texture. So that makes sense if this is saying that I have coarse hair. It says your hair has a medulla, or an often hollow core of hair that can fill with water. Often found in gray hair type, but can be in any hair type. So not everyone has that innermost layer, especially those with fine hair. I was reading don't usually have the medulla layer, so that's interesting. So this says that the elasticity test indicates that I need more protein, which is why my hair tends to really respond well to protein ingredients. It also describes the differences between large and small proteins, which is one of the things that we discussed in the protein video that I mentioned. And it will tell you which type of proteins your hair would benefit from the most, which is really helpful. All right, the next photos show the split ends. This is so bad. I definitely have split ends, and I recently trimmed my hair, so hopefully I got some of these. And I always kind of, whenever I spot them, I will try and snip them, but they look so bad in the pictures. It explains how splits and frays in hair create openings in which too much water may enter and cause the hair to swell. So that can lead to more frizz, more breakage. It says you begin losing water-soluble proteins through the cracks. So having that split end just loses moisture and also loses protein. So that's why damaged hair really likes protein, because it's lost its protein where it's split. The next thing that was in my report was about buildup. So apparently I had some buildup on my hair, and you can actually see it in the photos. I will insert one of the photos here so you can see. So it shows where there's like little specks, I guess you would say, along the surface of my hair, and that indicates buildup, which is so interesting because I even clarified my hair. And I'm trying to remember which clarifying wash that I used. I wanna say I did an apple cider vinegar rinse. So that's really surprising to me that there was still buildup on my hair, and that kind of tells me that I was probably using products beforehand that caused the buildup. So then the report goes over the environmental effects of product performance, which I've talked about in videos before, but basically if you live in an area where the dew points are very high, then you can tend to have more frizz from humidity and stuff. And I live in Virginia, so it's always usually humid. We don't usually have a lot of dry months, maybe some in the winter time. But basically my hair is just so sensitive to humidity. So if I go outside, it usually frizzes up very easily, especially with being high porosity. It just does not hold on to products very easily. And the next section of the report goes over the products that I asked to see if they're compatible with my hair. So y'all know that I try out products all the time, but I try to think of the ones that are really my favorites and that I like to use the most. So that's the Amika Curl Corpse Defining Cream and the WeDag Climate Control Stronger Hold Gel. And so what they do is they look at the ingredients in the product and then analyze them to see if it's right for your hair. The Amika Curl Corpse Cream says that it does have glycerin and propylene glycol, which is a humectant. So this is not ideal during very humid months, but I usually seal in that cream with the gel that I'm gonna describe next. So usually when you use a product with glycerin as your base product and then seal it in, you're fine, but I wouldn't want to use the Amika cream by itself. So the next product that I listed was the WeDad Advanced Climate Control Heat and Humidity Gel. So this is one of my favorite gels. It's great for humidity. It's designed for humidity, so it does have polyquat ingredients in it, but this one doesn't tend to lead to buildup like some of the Curl Talk products can on my hair. This also has wheat amino acids and hydrolyzed wheat protein. So they said that they do recommend this gel for my hair, although it can build up on fine or damaged hair, and it does have a lot of slip to help detangle, and that's definitely why I like this gel, because it's very thin in texture, so it's easy to work with and it doesn't clump up, or it's just easier to work with my damaged hair. It gets through a lot easier because it's more of a watery gel. So then it also describes more film forming humectants that are in this gel, which make it a good product for high heat and humidity and combating frizz and extreme dew points, which is why I like to use it, because it's humid here and I have that high porosity. It's evident that I had the buildup. It could be from the polyquat ingredients, like I was saying, especially because I use mainly the Not Your Mother's products that I know have a lot of those before I did this analysis, so I probably had some buildup there. My thoughts on that are that I don't think I should stop using those products just because they cause buildup, because I need that protection from humidity, and the only way usually to do that is with sealing ingredients like these ingredients. So if I want to protect my hair from humidity in the summer, I'm just going to have to clarify it more frequently, which is okay. In the wintertime, maybe I could avoid using these products that can build up on the hair, and then I won't have to wash my hair as much. So it's a give and take, I guess. So the next product that I listed was the Not Your Mother's Curl Talk Defining Cream, and I just wanted to list that out just to see how they explained, you know, the buildup and stuff, because I knew that that one can lead to buildup. It says C13-14 isoparaffin can cause buildup. It says if you choose to continue using this product, just make sure you clarify more regularly, about 2 to 3 times a month, to ensure you effectively remove that ingredient from the surface of your hair. So I have noticed that I need to clarify about 3 times a month when I'm using those products that can lead to buildup. But when I'm using products that don't have that, I only have to clarify like once a month. And it explains how the Curl Talk products have keratin amino acids, which is a great gentle protein. Various plant extracts also help provide protein and act as a film forming humectant. So then they give several pages of care and styling recommendations. This is especially beneficial if you are new to taking care of your naturally curly hair, because they go over tons of different methods on how to apply your products, and it's so detailed, and it's nice to have it in written form for those that are new to it. So one of the recommendations for my wash day routine is to incorporate a pre-wash or a pre-poo treatment. So like I said before, using that moisturizing oil first before I shampoo can reduce breakage on my highly porous hair. One of the other things that I loved that this report includes is which type of clarifying treatments that I should use. So clarifying was one of the recommendations that I should do more often, which I know that I need to clarify if I'm gonna keep using some of those products. So I like how it showed the right type of clarifying ingredients that I should look for my hair type. Next recommendation is for me to use an oil to lock in moisture and seal my hair's cuticle, which I need to incorporate oils more at the last step of my styling routine because I typically don't. I usually just use gel and call it a day. So the final section is addressing the hair goals and frustrations that I listed out. So I listed out frizz, low density, sensitive to humidity, tangles easily, breaks easily, and grows slow and doesn't retain length. So all of the stuff that they described previously pretty much answers my question as to why my hair breaks so easily and why it frizzes up. It's because it's high porosity. So one of the questions on the questionnaire when I was sending in my sample was about hard water and whether if I have hard water or not. They can also look it up based on where you live. So I put that I have borderline hard water because we've actually tested ours here and it shows up as almost being hard, but not quite. We also have a brand new house, so a lot of times it can read normal at first and then over time show up more hard, so that could be it. But basically, if you have hard water, you have to use clarifying shampoos that have certain ingredients that actually remove hard water buildup. Hard water can cause so much harm to the hair and prevent moisture from getting in, so I just have to clarify with the right type of clarifying shampoo. So one of the things that was very helpful on their website was their virtual product aisle. So they have this shop on their site to where you can actually filter the products down by all of these different characteristics that we've talked about. So if you're looking for a clarifying cleanser, if you're looking for products that contain film-forming humectants, those type of filters, you can search for that on their website and then you can shop from there. So that's very beneficial. I think it takes you to Amazon so you can just order the products that you need, but it's a great way to kind of look through the products and have that way of telling which ingredients are in which products. So I would recommend starting there if you're looking to change up your products. Okay, so that was definitely a lot. Hopefully I didn't bore you with all of those details, but this stuff is just so fascinating and so helpful to me. Thank you again to MyManeBio for giving me this hair analysis. It was so useful and I was definitely taken aback by some of this stuff, and y'all have been just so helpful through this whole process. So I will include my discount code, like I said, down below if you guys are interested in checking it out for yourself. Please let me know if you decide to order a hair care analysis. I would love to hear about your results when you get them back. Definitely let me know. You can always shoot me a DM on Instagram or an email, and I would love to hear about your results. So I'm gonna include a little summary too on the blog post that goes with this video about these results, and I'll explain a little bit more about some of the stuff that I talked about. So the link for that will be in the description box down below as well. And if you're just getting started on your natural hair journey, I also have a playlist called The Curly Hair Care for Beginners. If you haven't yet seen it, I will put that linked down below where we go over all the basics of taking care of curls and break it down in simple, easy to follow steps. So that's it for today's video. Thank you all so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you have not already, and I hope to see you back next week. Bye, everyone.